Hello, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
India Campaign Committee and Fit India Club, Manipur University, present a virtual series of national talks starting from today, 25 May up to June 4, 2021. Today is the first day of this series of national talk on a topic, diabetics, its complications and management during the pandemic. In this connection, let me welcome each one of you present here. First of all, I would like to welcome our Registrar of the Manipur University, Professor W. Sanbabu Singh. I welcome you, sir. And I would like to have a warm welcome all the respected faculty members and non-teaching staff and all the students, those who are present over here. I welcome everyone for this first series of national talk. So, secondly, I would like to warm welcome eminent speaker, Dr. Rupam Choudhury from Guwahati. Thank you so much, sir, very much for your accepting our invitation to be present here. Thank you so much, sir. So I would like to welcome to the moderator, Professor N. Moilan Maitai, Head, Department of Zoology, Manipur University. I welcome you, sir, as a moderator for this first session, sir. And I would like to welcome Srimati T. Dipamanjuri Devi, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Manipur University. I welcome you, madam, as a co-moderator for this first session now. Thank you. Well, everyone, sir. So I would like to request again to the co-moderator, Dipamanjuri Madam, to have introduced to the eminent speaker, Dr. Rupam Choudhury. Please, Madam.
Thank you, Dr. Santos. A very good morning to everybody. Respected Sir Moderator, Professor N. Mohilal Maitai, Head of Department Zoology, Manipur University, Dr. L. Santos Singh, Convener, Fit India Campaign Committee and Fit India Club, Manipur University, and all the learned colleagues and their students who have joined this link to listen to this talk program. So we have, as part of the virtual series of national talks during COVID-19 second wave pandemic, we have Dr. Rupam Choudhury, diabetologist, metabolist, who will be presenting a talk on the topic diabetes, its complications and management during pandemic. Dr. Rupam Choudhury is an MD physician with a PhD in diabetes from Indian Diabetes Research Foundation, Chennai, with a fellowship in diabetology from Apollo, Chennai. Dr. Choudhury has also done a PhD diploma in lipid management from Middlesex University, London, UK. And Dr. Choudhury has served as a former consultant diabetologist in Sun Valley Hospital, Guwahati. And Dr. Choudhury is a consultant diabetologist in Apollo Clinic and Metro Hospital, Guwahati. And Dr. Choudhury has contributed a lot in clinical trials as an investigator in multiple national clinical trials, and has also served as a faculty member in 2020 in RSSGI. Dr. Rupam Choudhury is also a life member of such reputed associations as ADA, EASD, Endocrine Society, RSSGI, NADS, ACD, etc. So we are lucky to have Dr. Rupam Choudhury as our first speaker on the virtual series of national talks during COVID-19 second wave pandemic. So Dr. Choudhury will present on the topic diabetes, its complications and management during pandemic.
Thank you so much. I would request.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. I would like to hand over this session to the moderator, Professor N. Mohilan Maitai. Please proceed, sir.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Santos. Good morning, Dr. Rupam Choudhury. Good morning, everybody, all the participants. Very good morning. And on my own behalf also, I welcome all of you to this campaign, the series one. And I would like to show my gratitude to the Fit India Campaign Committee and the Fit India Club, Manipur University, for allowing us to participate in this series one. And I'm also lucky that Dr. Rupam will be presenting a paper on diabetes and its complication and the management during pandemic, and which is very relevant in this COVID-19 pandemic. And I would also like to share with the participants that diabetes is one of the most important chronic diseases that affects our body in a way where we cannot control the manufacturing of energy from the food. And as far as I know, what I read from literatures, in diabetes, about, say, 422 million people worldwide are affected with diabetes. And the premature mortality has increased about 5% in recent years. And about 1.5 million deaths have occurred since 2019 due to diabetes-related diseases. And it is one of the major causes of blindness, as Dr. Rupam will be informing us. And it is also a cause for the kidney failure, heart attack, strokes, and liver diseases like that. And this disease can be controlled, as our doctor will be telling us. This disease can be controlled and it can be prevented. So now I would like to request Dr. Rupam Choudhury to continue his paper presentation on diabetes. And after this, within this, you can present your questions in the set column. And we'll jot down the questions, and Dr. Rupam will be answering all the questions after he delivers his lecture. So may I now invite Dr. Rupam Choudhury to kindly deliver his talk. Doctor, please.
Yeah, thank you so much. Warm good evening, good morning to all the delegates present out here. Myself, Dr. Rupam Choudhury, and I'll be talking about diabetes and how to manage the complications of diabetes at this infective period that we are going through right now. And during pandemic, it has become very important not only to seek medical help for the current situation, but also to control the chronic conditions like diabetes, hypertension, and other comorbidities that the patient has. So I would request the technical team to please allow me to share my slide, because the option is not present out here. If you can provide me the rights to share. No, I cannot share because the rights were not given to me.
Downside is here.
Yes. That's what. So you'll have to provide me right to share my slide so that I can share. This option is not highlighted.
Mr. Trilok, can you please allow him to share? Mr. Trilok-san.
Trilok?
Yes, yes. Yeah, it is done. Let me share my slides. Is my slides visible?
Yes, it's coming on nicely. Very nice.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So, at starting, this is the topic for today is diabetes mellitus and the complications and management during infective period. So, before we go towards the management of diabetes during infective period, we'll have to learn what is diabetes and what is the prevalence and epidemiology of diabetes. So, we start with those points first, and then we go towards the present condition. So myself, Dr. Rupam Choudhury, I'm practicing as a diabetologist and metabolic physician currently at Apollo Clinic, Guwahati, Assam, at Dispur. So to start with, this is the current scenario of prevalence of diabetes worldwide. As you can see here, in 2019, in entire world, we had 463 million people who were suffering from diabetes. And this number is going to be almost double by the end of 2045. So not only COVID, diabetes itself is a pandemic right now. To give more importance to these chronic conditions, non-communicable diseases, if we really want to bring down the mortalities of patients because of all infective diseases, if we don't to correct the underlying condition, the infective diseases can take more lives than expected. So according to International Diabetes Federation, 9.3% of adult age 20 to 79 years, a staggering 463 million people are living with diabetes worldwide. So in 2010, the global projection for diabetes in 2025 was 438 million. Still 5 years to go, the prediction that we had right now, it increased by 25 million and is predictable to grow over 550 million people by the year of 2035. A further 1.1 million children and adolescents under the age of 20 live with type 1 diabetes as well. So not only earlier, we have seen that people age more than 50 years or 50 years, they were suffering from diabetes and these chronic conditions, but nowadays the trend is changing and people with younger age are suffering from diabetes right now. We have patients who are 20 year old, even 17, 18, they are suffering from type 2 diabetes mellitus because of the environmental factor, the genetic factors, and the unhealthy lifestyle that we live in our country. This is the predisposition of diabetes in India. As you can see here, the highest prevalences were seen in western part, like in Rajasthan, in Gujarat, and also we have higher prevalence in southern part of India. Probably because the diagnostic modalities were much advanced, and people are more getting diagnosed. In western part of India, we had prevalence of 19.8% in Arunachal Pradesh, and also in Assam we have 0.6%. These figures are not very reliable because the prevalence studies were not adequately done in northeastern India. Only one paper that was published in 2012, that was also done by my teacher, Dr. A. Ramachandran, who found that 13.4% population of Assam had diabetes at that point of time, and probably it has gone up more than 20-25% by year 2021, because nowadays every family has got one or two diabetic patients that we see in clinical setting. So let us talk a little bit about diabetes mellitus type 1. We know that diabetes mainly are two types, type 1 and type 2. Also, we have a very prevalent diabetes condition that is called GDM, that is gestational diabetes mellitus, that happens during pregnancy. So these are main groups of types of diabetes. And also we have other genetic types of diabetes, but they are very rare. So let us take up type 1 diabetes in young. As per IDF Atlas 2019, in India, out of 1 lakh population, less than 5 children has got type 1 diabetes. In Europe, it is highest. The prevalence of type 1 diabetes is very high in found in Europe. Again, having said that, I would have to mention that the diagnosis of type 1, it's a difficult job. And, I mean, considering the medical condition and availability of doctors and medical modalities in India, the diagnosis of type 1 is done very lately, and sometimes it is also misdiagnosed. So the prevalence would really go high in India as well. But for now, on paper, we have less than 5% out of 1 lakh per annum prevalence of type 1 diabetes that happens in 0 to 14 years of children. If you compare all the continents here after Europe, Southeast Asia has got also a high number of type 1 diabetes that were found in society. Talking about incidence of type 1 diabetes, incidence increasing by 3.4% per year, 50% of patient diagnosed before age 20, 50% of patient diagnosed after age of 20. So it is not always true that type 1 happens only in children. We can see type 1 diabetes mellitus also in adolescent age and after 20 years age too. So see 50-50 predisposition is there. 50% is below 20 years of age and 50% above 20 years. It is often mistaken for type 2 diabetes mellitus and may make up 10 to 30% of individuals diagnosed with type 2 diabetes mellitus. So many a times, type 1 diabetes is misdiagnosed as type 2 diabetes and they have been put on type 2 diabetic treatment that does not help. So type 1 diabetes would require insulin lifelong because their insulin production is absolutely gone down. Oral agents ineffective in type 1 diabetes, insulin therapy is required. Autoimmune process slower and possibly different. Confirmed by islet cell antibodies. So why type 1 diabetes is not diagnosed properly? Because we need to have some autoantibody testing, which are not available everywhere. So we need to have, for example, islet cell antibodies. We'll have to see, get autoantibodies, insulin autoantibodies to diagnose type 1 diabetes mellitus. So these are some reasons why the diagnosis of type 1 diabetes mellitus can be misdiagnosed at times. The causes of type 1 diabetes are beta cell autoimmunity. So what happens is in pancreas, we have beta cells that produces insulin. And these beta cells are totally killed by our own autoantibodies. And that's why the production of insulin is hampered and we have zero insulin production. That's why the patient requires insulin for lifelong. Some environmental changes also affects and lead to type 1 diabetes mellitus. And of course, we have genetic predisposition in type 1 diabetes patients. It is definitely less common than type 2 diabetes mellitus. Almost more than 90% of our patients are type 2 diabetes. Only around 5% we have type 1 diabetes, and other 5% are different other groups of diabetes that we see in clinical setup. Etiology wise, we have seen there are three theories. If a child has got viral infections like mumps, rubella, CMV, cytomegalovirus, mono infections in early phase of their life, then it can lead to a production of antibodies against those viruses, and then those autoantibodies can affect the beta cells and kill them. So this is one postulated theories which can lead to type 1 diabetes mellitus. Genetic predisposition, these are HLA-DR3/4 genotypes and HLA-DQ-point mutation. These are some mutations and some type of genotypes which leads to type 1 diabetes mellitus. And autoimmune inflammations of islet cell that we have already talked. So we have autoantibodies against the islet cell that kills the beta cells of pancreas, and we have decremental insulin production in body, and ultimately that leads to type 1 diabetes mellitus. So marked absolute insulin deficiency resulting from diminished beta cell mass leads to lower serum insulin levels and hence type 1 diabetes mellitus. This is a natural history how a pre-type 1 diabetic becomes a fulminant type 1 diabetes. As you can see in your left hand side, when a person has got beta cell mass. So beta cells are the cells that produce insulin. It was 100%. Then we have genetic predisposition where the patient can have putative triggers like we talked about the viral infections, and gradually because of the cellular autoimmunity that affects the beta cells, the beta cell got inflammation, which is insulinitis, and eventually the beta cell deficiency happens and patient ultimately becomes type 1 diabetic when less than 10% beta cells are there and it is not enough to secrete insulin in body and take care of the hyperglycemia. Little bit about type 2 diabetes mellitus, which is very prevalent in our society. So as we have talked about already, the projection of diabetic patient in India is almost doubling from 2019 to 2045. On paper, actually, China is the world capital of diabetes because, again, probably their diagnosis is better than Indian subcontinent. But then actually, India is the diabetic capital of the world, as 49% of our patients are not even diagnosed. 20 to 30% patients, they never go to a doctor or a healthcare facility to get their blood sugar checked. So this, what we see on paper is only 50% of patients who got lucky and got diagnosed to have type 2 diabetes, and then they have the opportunity to have medication. Another 50%, they don't even know that they have this condition. For the IDF, International Diabetes Federation 2009, 1 in 11 adults have diabetes in worldwide. 1 in 5 of the people with diabetes in the world come from Southeast Asia. So in Southeast Asia, diabetes, type 2 diabetes is very prevalent. In the entire world, you take 5 diabetic patients, 1 out of those will be from Southeast Asia. 1 in 6 adults with diabetes in the world come from India alone. So out of 6 patients, 1 will be Indian. 1 in 2 people with diabetes remain undiagnosed and are at a higher risk of developing harmful and costly complications. If the patient doesn't know that they have this condition called diabetes, the patient will not take any medical help. And then because of the hyperglycemia, high blood sugar, the complications will appear very early. 1.2 million deaths are attributable to diabetes, which brings a lot of cost. I mean, if you see the cost of treatment of chronic conditions like diabetes, hypertension is very high, because this is not for 1 month, 2 months, the treatment will go lifelong. Also, I will have to mention that 1 in 4 live births are affected by hyperglycemia in pregnancy. So we talked about GDM, gestational diabetes mellitus, the pregnancy-related diabetes. Right now, out of 4 live births, 1 lady will have these conditions, and although after delivery, the sugars will come down, but the patient will become diabetic within 6 months to 1 year to 2 year. The chances are very high, like 70 to 80%. This is as per the ICMR INDIAB 2017 data, where they have shown that urban population has got very high amount of diabetes prevalence in India as compared to the rural population. And if you compare male and female, male has got higher incidences as compared to female. This is again probably because males have got more diagnostic opportunity compared to female, because rural females, we know in many parts of India, they are uneducated and they are barred of medical help of any kind. This we have already mentioned. IDF estimates 72.9 million people with diabetes in India in 2017, with almost 3.5 million people in India with diabetes being unaware of their diabetic status. So situation is not good. If you really want to what is pandemic, of course COVID-19 is denoted as a pandemic right now, but if you compare the mortality rates, more people are dying out of diabetes and its complications rather than the acute infections that we are encountering right now. So we can also denote diabetes as a real pandemic in entire world, along with, I mean, its complications, the cardiovascular, the heart attacks it causes, the strokes it causes. 30 to 40% patients will have kidney failure, some amputations because of diabetes. I would have to mention that every 10 seconds, one limb is being amputated because of complications of diabetes. So these things, people are unaware, and we'll have to work more on awareness of complications of diabetes to prevent death and those amputations and heart attacks and stroke. So only controlling sugar is not enough. We'll now that the development of more scientific knowledge of diabetes, we'll have to move towards preventing complications rather than only controlling the blood sugar levels in our patients. Also, we'll have to mention that Southeast Asian patients are different from the Western counterparts. As you can see on your right hand side, these are Indian patients. Indian patients are known as thin fat Indian phenotype. We are very thin from outside as compared to Western patients, but then there are a lot of visceral adiposity. That means a lot of fat inside our body. That is the reason why Indian population have more insulin resistance and the number of diabetics are increasing day by day. The pathophysiology, how diabetes happens in the Indian population, because of beta cell dysfunction, less insulin production, we have greater post-meal hyperglycemia. That means after meal, the PP blood sugar is very high in Indian population as compared to the Western population. Also because our diet is very high in carbohydrates. If you see the Northeastern population, we have inclusion of rice in every meal of our day, and the amount of carbohydrate is very high, and that is one reason why we have very high hyperglycemia, high blood sugars after meal in Northeastern part as compared to the other part of India. Rapid progression of pre-DM to over DM in Indian population, this is seen. So if somebody is pre-diabetic, they become fulminant diabetic very fast in diabetic Indian population as compared to the Western population. The decline in beta cell is very sharp in Indian population, and also rapid oral drug failure. So we have different kind of drugs for diabetes. We have pills that is taken orally, and when pills does not work, we'll have to give insulin in patient, which is injectable hormone. So this rapid oral drug failure is seen more in Indian population as compared to the Western population. Little bit about how insulin acts in our body. So as you can see here, in healthy population, we have the pancreas, which has got beta cell that secretes insulin when they get a signal from our duodenum. When we eat food, the food goes to duodenum after stomach, and then it gives signal to the pancreas that we need to secrete insulin to carry the glucose to cells. So the function of insulin is it acts as a carrier to carry the glucose from blood to all the cells. So for example, I'm thinking I need to use glucose as a source of energy. My brain utilizes 70% of glucose to think. So intellectual people, if they're not working also, they're only thinking and doing intellectual work, they're utilizing a lot of glucose. So this glucose has to come from blood to every cell by using the glucose, and it goes into Krebs cycle, TCA cycle, and then we secrete ATPs as the source of energy. So as you can see here, it is the glucose and it enters to the cell, and we have energy production inside the cell in general condition. So now again, insulin acts as a key to open the receptors, which is called the insulin receptor, which is present in the cell. So now when we have less insulin, the sugar is not carried from blood to cell. That's why we have high amount of sugar in blood, but the cells are not getting sugar for energy production. Again, what happens in type 2 diabetes is this receptor, they gets closed. So less insulin, less carrier of glucose. Insulin again acts as a key to open the receptors, so that is also not happening, and these receptors are closed because of insulin resistance. So amalgamation of all these factors ultimately leads to high sugar in blood, and that is called hyperglycemia, and that's how type 2 diabetes happens. So again, the same procedure is depicted here. When we eat, the blood glucose goes ups and down throughout the day, and your blood glucose rises after meal. The pancreas releases insulin, and the insulin acts as a key, carries the glucose to other tissues for energy production. Now in type 2 diabetes, the pancreas may not produce enough insulin, that is called insulin deficiency, and your cell don't use insulin properly. The insulin can't fully unlock the cell to allow glucose to enter, and this insulin resistance. So this is how the sugars increases in blood, but the cells are not getting any glucose to produce energy. Along with that, what happens is we have these conditions called glycogenolysis, gluconeogenesis, and glycogenesis, which happens in liver. So in diabetic patient, what happens is the hepatic glucose output, that means the sugar production from liver, increases specifically at night. So that's why the glycogen, we know it's a storage of energy in liver that converts into glucose, and this procedure increases in diabetic patient, known as increased glycogenolysis. Again, when the cells are not getting enough glucose, what it tries to is it tries to extract glucose from non-carbohydrate sources of energy, that is fat and protein, And from fat and protein, again, it produces new glucose molecules, which is called gluconeogenesis. And again, from glucose, the extra glucose that produced in body because of this gluconeogenolysis and gluconeogenesis, it again deposits in the liver in form of glycogen. So these three procedures and physiological conditions, which becomes pathological conditions, will lead to more and more blood sugars. Although cells are not getting sugar, but then sugar is increasing in body, blood glucose is increasing in body, and in bloodstream, we have very high level of sugar, which circulates throughout the body and hampers all the organs like kidneys, peripheral nerves. We have a problem in retina. We have more atherosclerosis, which is deposition of more amount of lipids, and it causes ultimately heart attack and stroke. Little bit about the insulin resistance. Major defect in individual with type 2 diabetes, we have already talked, insulin resistance is the closure of the receptor of insulin in every cell. So it reduced biological response to insulin happens in type 2 diabetes, and it's a strong predictor of type 2 diabetes mellitus, closely associated with obesity. So we are talking about Fit India movement today. We know more than 90% of our patients are obese who got diabetes. So obesity itself leads to insulin resistance, and along with environmental factor and decreased insulin secretion, the patient become fulminant diabetes. So 90% of people with type 2 diabetes are overweight or obese, and obesity itself leads to insulin resistance in our patient. This is an interesting fact. Did you know there are two types of body structures? One is called apple-shaped and pear-shaped. So apple-shaped, as you can see in the picture, apple-shaped patient or individuals, they have more visceral fat. Visceral fat is fat in our body. Related health problems like diabetes, hypertension, then they have higher chances of heart attack and stroke. Whereas pear shaped, they have less visceral fat and low risk of weight related heart health problems happening those kind of body structures. Now more than 80% of patients progressing to type 2 diabetes are insulin resistant. So insulin resistance, we have talked about that obesity itself and lack of physical exercise and increased visceral fat leads to insulin resistance, and it is found in more than 80% of our patients. This is the pathophysiological aspect of diabetes type 2 mellitus. It's a new concept known as the omnious octet. So you see, diabetes is not a unifactorial disease. Only decreasing insulin is not the cause. We have these 8 pathophysiological factors which leads to hyperglycemia, that means increased blood sugar, and diabetes happens. Even our brain is involved in increasing blood sugar in body. So neurotransmitter dysfunction, which is the problem with the brain transmission, signal transmission, that leads to hyperglycemia. Increased hepatic glucose production, we have talked about that the liver secretes more amount of sugar. So that contributes to hyperglycemia. Increased glucagon secretion. Glucagon is a hormone which increases sugar in body. It's a counter hormone of insulin. Insulin decreases sugar and glucagon increases. So this glucagon also increases in diabetes, that leads to more hyperglycemia. Decreased insulin secretion, we have talked about. Decreased incretin effect. So incretin effect is some hormones which are secreted by our gut. These are called GLP-1 and GIP-1s, which regulates the alpha cell and beta cells to produce insulin and glucagon and manage the homeostasis of glycemia in body. So it controls the highs and lows of sugar. And we have some problem with the incretin effect in diabetic patient. Again, it leads to hyperglycemia. Also, we have effect of kidney. The contribution of kidney in hyperglycemia. What happens in kidney is supposed to secrete the extra glucose that is found in our body. But then there is some problem in excretory function of glucose from kidneys that leads to hyperglycemia ultimately. So multi-factors are involved. That's why diabetes is called multifactorial disease, and we'll have to target all these factors with pharmacotherapies then only, along with pharmacotherapy, diet and exercise, we can control hyperglycemia in our patient. Little bit about the symptoms of diabetes. I think everyone is aware of these symptoms, but still will repeat those. Polyuria. Polyuria is more urination in patient. Increased thirst, also known as polydipsia, and weight loss. These are cardinal symptoms of diabetes type 2. Why polyuria happens is when we have high amount of glucose in our blood, the urine also carries the glucose, and along with one molecule of glucose, two molecules of water is carried away. So you have more amount of urination. Once you have more urination, you will feel more thirsty because it will give signal to brain that the fluid in body is less, we need to drink more water. That's why we have increased thirst. Weight loss, because we have learned that our peripheral cells, muscle cells, are not getting glucose. That's why those cells will eventually die and the patient will have weight loss. Increased hunger, also known as polyphagia. Why the patient feels more hunger? Because again, the cells are not getting glucose. It will send signal to brain that we are not getting glucose, please eat something. So this is how the patient also feels more hunger to compensate the less amount of glucose in peripheral cell. Uncommon signs are nausea, vomiting, lethargy, fatigue or weakness, hyperventilation. These are not very common. This happens in acute conditions when the patient also have infections. One more symptom I would like to mention is blurred vision and non-healing ulcers or wound. So what happens is when sugars are very high in your blood, our lens swells up and the patient feels blurred vision. And then once you bring down the sugars, the vision is corrected. So this is one symptom. Patient comes with these symptoms in early phase of their diagnosis. And also some wound, if which is not healing for a long period of time, that may be because of diabetes itself. Now let us talk about the diabetes complications that we have in our patient. We have talked that stroke and heart attack are very high in diabetic patient. In fact, once a patient becomes diabetic, the chances of heart attack is 4 to 5 times higher. Similarly, stroke also 4 to 5 times higher. This is because of increased fat deposition inside the vessels, which is called atherosclerosis. And by this process, the vessels are blocked, the arteries are blocked, and the heart is not getting enough blood. That's why the patient gets heart attack. Similarly, in brain also, the brain doesn't get good enough blood supply and it becomes a stroke. Nerve damage, these are called microvascular complications. So high amount of sugar, when it is circulating through our nerves, there are some pathways called sorbitol pathways and AGE, advanced glycosylated end products, which deposits in the nerve ending and patient have nerve damage. Not many patients complain burning sensation, tingling sensation over feet. So this is how nerve damage starts. We also have arteriosclerosis. We have talked about this is deposition of fat inside the arteries. Diabetic foot, a huge entity. So because of lack of blood supply in peripheral tissues through peripheral arteries, when arteries are blocked, the blood supply is not good. That's why even if some patient get small infection or some small wound that does not heal, and again, because of lack of immunity, the foot infection worsens, and ultimately we had to amputate the foot to save life of the patient. So diabetic foot has become a big entity now. Every 10 seconds, as I have mentioned, one foot is being amputated in entire world. Renal failure, because of high, 30 to 40% of our patients will have kidney failure. And this entity is again a very important thing we'll have to take care of, because if you go to a dialysis unit, out of 10 patients, 9 patients will be diabetic. So now diabetic kidney disease has become a huge cause of mortality amongst diabetic population. And eye disease. Many patients, our population does not, they are not aware that diabetes itself can cause blindness. And this blindness is asymptomatic blindness. What happens is because of hyperglycemia, high blood sugar, there are some new vessels that produce in our retina, and these vessels bleed. So every year, if the patient checks his retina, we always send our patient to the retina specialist or eye doctor, who does a fundoscopy and sees if there is some spot then immediately we can do laser treatment and block those bleeding points. But as the patients are asymptomatic, they seldom, this us and go to eye doctor, and the bleeding increases. And once the posterior chamber is filled with blood, the patient becomes blind without any pain, without any complaint. And there's nothing much we can do at this point when the patient posterior chamber is already filled with blood. So this is number one cause for asymptomatic blindness worldwide right now, diabetic retinopathy. So we'll have to be aware of this entity as well. Coming back to the infective period, pandemic, the management of diabetes, we'll have to first understand what happens if a diabetic patient gets infection. And you might have heard that diabetes reduces the immune response of body. So immunity is very less in diabetic patient. Why this happens is these are the factors. So diabetes, long-standing diabetes, can impair the cytokine production. Cytokine kinds are cells which fight the infection, whether it is viral or antibacterial or fungal. So this cytokine production is impaired because of long duration diabetes. Leukocyte, we know they are also forefront warriors of our body to fight against infections. So this leukocyte recruitment inhibition happens because of diabetes. So if you have infection, the leukocytes are supposed to come, the white blood cells, they're supposed to come and fight back the virus or bacteria, but it does not happen in diabetic patients. Third defect is defect in pathogen recognition. So what happens when we have some infection, viral or bacterial, the body recognizes the pathogen, then it produces antibodies which engulfs the virus or bacteria and kills it. Now in diabetes, what happens? We have some defects in pathogen recognition, and the body cannot fight against the virus or bacteria. Neutrophil dysfunction, similarly like leukocyte recruitment inhibition, neutrophils, they also have dysfunction, they cannot fight. We in body, we have natural killer cell, which again fights against viruses and bacteria and infections. And there also we have dysfunction. Macrophage, which engulfs the bacteria or virus, there also we have dysfunction. So in a nutshell, what we have is entire immune system is compromised because of long-standing diabetes, because we had hyperglycemia for many years, and all our systems are impaired and they cannot fight against infection. Both innate immune system is an immune system that we have from birth, including dysfunction of neutrophil and macrophages, and dysfunction of the adaptive immune response. So there are two types of immunity. One is innate immunity, which we have from childhood, from birth, and one is adaptive immune response, which we get from environmental factors. So somebody who is growing up in a tropical area, so they will be immune to tropical infections. But if you bring someone United Kingdom to India, they will not have those antibodies and protection against tropical infections. Even malaria can kill patients. So this adaptive immune response is also hampered because of diabetes, and hence they become immunocompromised. So in infection, what happens is viral infection, talking about the COVID infection that we have currently, we have viral infection, but the immune response is suppressed in diabetic patient. On top of that, we are giving steroid to our patients to tackle the COVID infections, because their lung is already compromised. If we don't use steroid, the patient might die. So we had to use steroid in those patients, along with compromised immune system and other comorbidities, like somebody has heart problem, somebody has kidney problem, the patient's mortality increasing. So more patients are dying who have diabetes and comorbidities from COVID-19 infection, other than other patients who are very healthy, who does not, they recover very well. Now, let us talk about the black fungus. So this has become a big news now. Black fungus happens in diabetic patients, and there are a lot of cases found in states like Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala. In Assam also, last week we got one case of black fungus, which is also known as mucormycosis. It's a diabetic patient, long-standing, and he had COVID infection, and at that time the patient had to be put on steroids, and then patient developed black fungus or mucormycosis of nose, and that spread to brain. So let us learn what is black fungus. Scientifically, it is called rhinocerebral mucormycosis. Mucormycosis is a rare opportunistic and invasive infection. See, very important point, opportunistic. So opportunistic infection happen when you already have an infection and then your immunity is down, and then some other organism, it again tries to grow in your body, and then again these conditions appear. So opportunistic and invasive infection caused by fungi of the class Jugomycetes, the genus most commonly associated with human infection is the Rhizopus, followed by Mucor and Cunninghamella. This infection occurs in approximately 50% of cases of individual with diabetes due to the greater availability of glucose. Now, if this fungus, they love glucose because this is a food for them, and they can grow very fast when your sugars are not under control. And then this pathogen that causes mucormycosis. The mucormycosis can be acute and chronic. The classical triad is characterized by paranasal sinusitis. So we have infection in our sinuses of our nose. So it starts from there. Then we have ophthalmoplegia. We have severe pain in one side of one eye, where the sinuses, the side where the sinuses, the nasal cavity is affected. And then it can even cause blindness if it spreads to the eyeball. And the unilateral proptosis, that with cellulitis. So the eye will come out, and then we have cellulitis, which is infection of the surrounding tissues of the eye. Facial or eye pain and necrotic wound of the palate of the nasal mucosa may occur. So it, the palate of mouth can be infected with this fungus. And black necrotic ischia is the nasal cornet, is a characteristic sign. So that's why it is called black fungus, because it causes black colored necrotic ischia. Ischia is like when we have wound and then it is healing, and then we have some black covering of this wound. Similarly, in our cavities, nasal or oral cavities, we have this black necrotic ischia. Necrotic means these are dead tissues. So that's why it is called black fungus. And this, the mortality is very high. How to prevent black fungus is, we'll have to keep our blood sugars under control, and judicial use of steroid has to be done. So these are some pictures how black fungus look. As you can see here, we can see in picture B, we can see the infection, the necrotic tissues, that black one. And picture A is after removing the necrotic tissue. Here we can see an eye canthus, in corner of eye, we have this mucormycosis, the black ischia that is seen. These are a few last slides. Let us also take up a few questions that we get from our patients as a physician. These are common queries from diabetic patients during COVID pandemic. So I'm getting a lot of calls these days. My diabetic patients were calling up and asking me this question. I thought to share with you, because probably these are also common questions that we hear day to day from diabetic patients. Question number one, I'm a diabetic, can I take the vaccine for COVID? So definitely the answer is, if you are diabetic, you need to get vaccinated as soon as possible. But the thing is that it is recommended that your blood sugars has to be under control before vaccinating yourself. So what happens is, whenever you take an injection, there are chances that in injection site, you can have some amount of some pus collection if your sugars are not under control. So get your sugars under control, and definitely you should get vaccinated if you're diabetic. Question number two, what happens if my sugars are high during vaccination period? So I have already mentioned, very high sugars can lead to injection site infections. Otherwise, high sugar is not contraindicated for vaccination. So we always encourage our patient, diabetic patient, to get vaccinated, because those are the patients who can land up in ICU if they get viral infection like COVID. If yes, which vaccine? Lot many questions. Should I get or we should get a vaccine which is more efficacious. See, any vaccine which is 70%, which has demonstrated 70% efficacy, is good enough. It's your body immune system that determines how much of antibodies it will produce. So the two vaccines we have right now in India, Covishield and Covaxin, both are efficacious enough, and it gives good amount of production of autoantibodies against COVID. And whichever you get grasp of, please get vaccinated and take. Number four question is, I have taken vaccine and got fever. What? So this is very common. 50% of our patients who are getting vaccinated, they get fever for 24 hours and 48 hours. So nothing to worry. This is because the body is producing antibodies. So antibodies, when you have antibodies in your immune system, it is natural to get some increment of body temperature, because they think that this is a kind of infection and they wanted to fight back. The body immune system wanted to fight back. Only taking paracetamol and taking some rest and a lot of fluid intake can take care of this. And within 48 hours, it is seen that the fever is going down. Number five, what medicine should I take for sugar control during COVID infection? So many patients are on oral drugs for diabetes management. But once you have some kind of infection, whether it is COVID or other severe infection, you have sepsis, septicemia, or you have diabetic foot infection or some wound, infected wound, it is always advisable to take insulin as a drug to control blood sugars, because insulin is not only a sugar control, sugar reducing medicine, it's in fact a hormone which is supposed to be produced by our body. And insulin is an anabolic hormone which helps in boosting the immunity as well. So insulin during the infective period, this is called the sick day rule. During sick days, insulin is the best thing. And then once the infection goes down, the sugar will also go down. I need to mention that any infection in body, like if you have ear infection or tooth infection, the sugars will go very high. And that time, insulin is the key. And then after the sugars and infection subsides, we can reduce the insulin and stop insulin and put the patient on oral pills for diabetes control. Number six is, how frequently should I check my sugar during infective period? So once you get infection, the sugar control is very, it's vital. So we advise the patient to check 6 times a day. The patients who are admitted in hospital, we check before breakfast, after breakfast, before lunch, after lunch, before dinner, after dinner. That will give us an idea. We can speculate a graph how the sugar fluctuation is, and accordingly we can decide the doses of insulin or drugs, oral drugs, whichever is applicable. So if you are quarantined at home, then at least checking 6 times is very cumbersome. So what we advise our patient is, you check fasting and after breakfast one day, check next day like after lunch, and third day maybe after dinner. So that will give us, and we can do it rotatory basis, one day after breakfast, one day after lunch, one day after dinner, and fasting maybe in twice or thrice a week. With all this data, a doctor can speculate the graphs, the fluctuation, the glycemic variability, how sugars are fluctuating, and then he can then decide what drugs or what doses of insulin you require. So this is a technique at home how we can check. And please make note of all your sugar readings, make charts according to date and timing, and then you can present or send your doctor your readings and he can give you advice. Number seven question is, how what complications I can have post COVID? So now specifically patients who have chronic conditions like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, kidney problem, after recovering from COVID also, they are complaining of a lot of involvement of their organs. Like there is one term called post-COVID lethargy syndrome. The patient will complain of severe weakness for like months, even 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, they can carry on this with this condition. So severe weakness. And then in post-COVID conditions, if lung is involved, they might have some problem in breathing. So after recovering from COVID, the mantra is to take control your sugars, control your blood pressure, take healthy food, and drink a lot of fluid. recover from this condition and then to regain the immunity. Of course, we prescribe vitamin C, vitamin D, vitamin E to our patients, which helps in immunity boosting. And as far as exercise is concerned, immediately after COVID, you should not exercise. Slow and steady, we can start walking, and then after like 1 month or two, we can do the regular exercises that are advised by your physician. At last, on a lighter note, I'll discuss a little bit about the diet. So this is about northeastern part of India. Our diet, if you see the picture, 70 to 80% of our plate is filled of carbohydrate, that is rice. And moreover, in places like Manipur, you tend to use sticky rice, which is very high in carbohydrate. So from, you see here, if you take this thali, the amount of protein that we have in, for example, this chicken dish, we have 2-3 pieces of small chicken, which is the protein source, and a lot of potatoes, which is again carbohydrate, and we have rice, which is again carbs. So we'll have to train from this kind of food, we'll have to have a balanced food. And for like sweet dish also, we use in every product, we have some amount of rice, which is again source of carbohydrate and glucose to our patient. So we'll have to shift to some healthy diet, and did not to mention about those gulab jamuns and rasgullas that we have. After having a very high carbohydrate meal, again, we tend to take sweets like which are very high in carbohydrate. So we'll have to refrain from that and make a healthy plate. So as you can see here, 50% of our plate should be green with fruit and vegetables. Then brown rice and wholemeal breads can be taken up in 1/3, one fourth and portion, and meat and other dairy products should be there in 1/4. So this is how a balanced diet looks like. If you think about Indian diet, definitely these are very spicy. We cannot eat bland diets, but then just for a reference, probably this is a balanced diet where we have equal amount of all the veggies and protein, and also it looks delicious. So we'll have to have a good balance of healthy eating, physical activity, and medication, of course, from your physician, which has to be balanced to control your blood sugars. Taking medication won't help. Only eating healthy without medication or physical exercise won't help. So there are three pillars like diet, exercise, and medication. All has to go hand in hand to have a good sugar control. So success mantra, diet, exercise, inner transformation. So stress level itself can increase blood sugars. So we'll have to refrain from stress. Nowadays, working from home, sitting in front of computer for hours and hours, that also brings stress. So we'll have to do whatever we like to do, like listening to music, meditation, yoga, that helps to reduce the stress level. And eventually we can control our blood sugars also. And along with that, we'll have to take advice of medical practitioners for our sugar control. So Fit India movement, 30 minutes of moderate exercise, 5 days a week can keep your diabetes under control. This is a message. So 30 minutes is minimum. If we can increase it, that gives us other benefits as well. Cardiac benefits, our muscles become more toned up, and then we have less chances of stroke, hypertension, diabetes, all. But minimum 30 minutes moderate exercise is recommended for diabetes. So at last, thank you so much for your patient hearing. So this is how the picture depicts. We have started from evolution, story of evolution, started from chimpanzees to become modern man. And again, we are going towards the same situation, and we are becoming inactive day by day, sitting in front of our computers. We'll have to change this, and to become healthy, we'll have to go out and do physical exercises to minimize the risk of these chronic conditions. Thank you so much. If there is anything we can discuss, I'll be happy to take up the questions.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rupam. It was a very nice presentation. I would like to specially appreciate you for the nice presentation. It's well informed. And basically, Dr. Rupam has talked elaborately on diabetes type 1 and diabetes type 2. And in diabetes type 1, he had elaborately talked on the viral infections like mumps that can cause these problems in the later years. And in type 2, especially on hyperglycemia, he elaborated on different aspects of diabetes. And interestingly, he has given us some new insights on the types of bellies that we have, especially in India. We have so many types of bellies. And he has emphasized that the apple sap is much more dangerous than the pear sap bellies. That's what he said. And he has also interestingly given us some new concepts of pathogenesis of hyperglycemia that was unheard of earlier. Especially he has elaborated on amalgamation of different effects, like say insulin, lipolysis, glucose reabsorption, etc., which are the main effects or main causes of this hyperglycemia. And most important also during this pandemic, he has elaborated that diabetes should be reduced at all levels. Otherwise, they will be causing the obstruction, the immune response, which is very much needed during this time of the pandemic. And he has emphasized that there should be improvement in cytokine, or rather the production of cytokine in leukocytes, then immune response, neutrophils, etc. And interestingly, in the last part, he has shown us some very nice pictures of the meals that we are having, the thalis that we are having. And from that, we have come to know that whatever we are eating, our big thalis in the lunch or probably in the dinner also, it is so much full of carbohydrates. So from today onwards, we should promise that the thalis should be changed. So what we do, the maximum amount of rice we pile up, and in the white curry also we put as much potatoes as we can. So there is no balance now. So that much clarity we have got from this talk, and I'm very indebted to Dr. Rupam. He has also elaborated on the black fungus, which is a big problem after this COVID-19. And especially though for those patients who were COVID positive, for them, post-COVID complications had come, and in that, the black fungus has been one of the main causes, and he has elaborated on that. And ultimately, at the last moment, he has given us some mantras where we can do away with diabetes during this pandemic. It can just diet, exercise, the inner transformation, and medicine. With these few words, I would like to thank Dr. Rupam. He has done very nicely. And in between, I also would like to inquire some questions regarding that. And from what we have got from the chat column, I think Dr. Santos, I think after I inquire something from doctor, can you please go on with the questions that we have been provided in the chat column? Now, one of the questions that I have seen is one, Moirangtem Kishan. He has inquired two questions, doctor. So I will ask that first. So Dr. Kishan has asked, number one, does mitochondrial oxygen intake reduce secretion of beta cells? So this is one question. Am I clear, doctor?
Yeah.
Does mitochondrial oxygen intake reduce secretion of beta cells? This is one question.
Yes.
And another is there any link between vitamins A and hyperglycemia? This is another question. Okay. Can you please answer that?
Yeah, please. I'll take up the first question. The oxygen uses in mitochondria, there are some, I know from where it is coming, there are some studies where, we are trying to find the cause of the involvement of mitochondrial pathogenesis, how it can reduce the beta cell, the insulin secretion from beta cell. Of course, there are some studies which postulates this condition where we have decreased oxygen supply to mitochondria and eventually the beta cell apoptosis happens. But then we don't have definitive answer yet. So I think there are more studies where to find out the molecular level pathogenesis that happens in type 2 diabetes. For now, grossly, we have beta cell apoptosis because of islet cell insulitis. So the inflammation that happens because of oxidative stress, that is already proven in rodents and in humans also. And insulitis is taken up as a main major cause for apoptosis of beta cell that leads to decrement in insulin secretion and eventually type 2 diabetes. I'm not sure if there are some definitive studies that postulate that prove this hypothesis, but then yes, I have read some where they are trying to get more answers about mitochondrial aberrations and pathogenesis of beta cell apoptosis.
Yes, thank you. What about the other question, doctor, regarding the connection between vitamins A and the hyperglycemia?
A, as far as my knowledge is concerned, vitamin A has no role regulation in hyperglycemia. Vitamin A, vitamin C, vitamin E, this and vitamin D, of course, we have a lot of people now after this infection. These vitamins are related to our immune system. So vitamin D, for instance, not only helps in boosting up the immunity, we know vitamin D is required for our bone health, but then there are a lot of papers now which says that there are extra skeletal benefit of vitamin D use. So this is again vitamin E, vitamin C also helps in immunity. But then vitamin A, direct relation with hyperglycemia, I'm not aware of.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. I have some inquiries, doctor. Actually, for the information of the participants, I would like to mention that Dr. Rupam Choudhury, he is considered the best diabetes consultant in Guwahati and in Assam. If I'm not wrong, if I am say right, or if I go with the social medias, then we can say that Dr. Rupam is the best diabetes consultant in Guwahati and Assam. That's as far as we know. This is one That's information not, for the yeah. participants. Here, doctor, actually, I would like to state something, because when we have high sugar, for example, I'm not a diabetic person, but even then, when we have the high sugar, what happens is allergies come to the skin, any form of allergies. So in connection with this COVID, this pandemic, suppose the immune system is suppressed, will there be chances for any fungus or any bacteria to infect the people who are immunocompromised?
Yes, sir, that's correct. Any immunocompromised condition can lead to more amount of infections, whether it is bacterial, fungal, or viral. So that's what we are seeing in case of mucormycosis. This is, the patient have COVID infection and lesser amount of immunity. So that's why the patient are getting these secondary infections on top of COVID. So any immunocompromised condition, likewise HIV AIDS we have, there also immunity is low. Patient never dies of HIV AIDS. They die of simple cough or cold. So because they don't have the immunity to fight back the normal infections, the secondary infection becomes a bigger issue, and they ultimately succumb to those conditions. So here also,
Doctor. And doctor, actually, as far as we know, these pathogens, maybe these viruses or anything, so what they rely is they rely on the food material, carbohydrate food material, sugar content. So if we reduce the sugar intake, can it help in the control of the COVID-19?
Very interesting thing, sir. I was reading day before yesterday, I was reading a paper that specifically says that the same thing you have mentioned, that they tried in a set of population zero carbohydrate diet, high protein and lot of fluid, and they have found good result with that. And they saw that the COVID-19 infection subsides very fast in those patients as compared to the other arm where the consumption of carbohydrate was high. So very new concept, but very interesting. I'm happy that sir has brought up this question. But invariably, sir, a diabetic patient, the situation is different. Even if you are not eating carbohydrate, your sugars might be high because of the higher hepatic glucose output. The glycogen converts into glucose. So we have to control those blood sugars with medication at that time. But in healthy individuals, zero carbohydrate, less sugar, high amount of protein. We all know that protein helps in immunity to fight against infections, and a lot of fluid that really helped. So we need to have more evidences, but very interesting point.
That's a very nice answer. Thank you very much, Dr. Rupam. And one more inquiry. Sometime in these diabetic patients, sometime when they have the medication, when they take some medicines, what happens is for the control of sugar, or it's almost controlled. But sometimes it so happens postpartum, after lunch, their sugar content suddenly increases. So in that, what medicine, what type of medicine should we be providing?
So what happens in infective period is because of the increase in cortisol, corticosteroid level. So when we have any kind of infections, our body itself will secrete corticosteroids from adrenal gland to fight against the infection. So it prepares the body to fight against with steroids. So these steroids, what they do is they increases blood sugar. So that's why in any infective period, the sugars will be very high. And that time, I mean, we as physicians, we use insulin therapy only. As an anabolic hormone, insulin really helps to bring down the blood sugar. Again, it will carry the blood sugar from bloodstream to cells. Then cells will have more like glucose. And I mean, cells will need energy to fight against the infection also. So this is how we deal with in acute conditions. And later on, once the infection goes down, sugar also go down, and then we'll taper down the insulin doses, and even we can stop insulin also. So this is
okay. Thank you. Now, can I pass on to our my co-moderator, Dr. Choudhury? Whether Dr. Choudhury is there? Ma'am, Dr. Choudhury, are you there? Okay, Dr. Santosh. Can you please continue? Because there are many questions. I do. Can you please continue with the questions from the participants?
Question, that's must say enough, sir. The others I couldn't see from the chat box. Yeah. Chat box. One question I found, sir. Chaugrakhan Kumarjit, he asked the question, is COVID-19 vaccine effective to the diabetic patient? This is the same question, same answer, Sir Rupam Choudhury, last slide. He wrote the answer in the last slide, I think. But he again asked the question, is the COVID-19 vaccines effective to the diabetic patient? This question only, sir.
Yeah. So I think this is the last question we'll have to take because I need to go to hospital. Thanks for your question. See, vaccines will not affect diabetic patients. If you are diabetic, you will have to get vaccinated as soon as possible. So vaccine will not save you from infections, but it will save you from going to ICU probably. I mean, the severe condition of infections, because you already have antibodies after vaccination, it will fight the infection. So vaccine is, I mean, not your certificate that you will not get COVID from anywhere. So even if you are diabetic, you should get vaccinated first of all. Diabetic patient, why we are emphasizing is because if a diabetic patient gets COVID, the chances of their condition worsening very fast is very high. So many patients, I mean, if I am diabetic, you are not, both get infected with same COVID-19, I might go to ICU and into ventilator because I have diabetes and other comorbidities. So a non-diabetic patient, the chances of recovery is better. That's why diabetic patients should get vaccinated first. So that was what we are advising to our patient.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Now, some of the questions also in the line, but okay, the timing also now running off. Okay. So this session is very reliable and extremely very useful for all the participants and the Northeast people's entire. So the topic, diabetes and its complication and management during the pandemic is very reliable. Thank you so much, doctor, on behalf of the Fit India Campaign Committee and Fit India Club, Manipur University. I would like to thanks again today's speaker, Dr. Rupam Choudhury, for sharing your valuable information during this pandemic situation regarding the diabetes. Thank you so much, sir, from your side. And then I would like to thank you to the moderator and co-moderator, Professor N. Moilan Maitai, Head, Department of Zoology, Manipur University, and Srimati T. Dr. Choudhury Devi, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Manipur University, for managing session smoothly and grand success for this first session's national talk. Thank you so much for moderator. And lastly, I'd like to thanks to the especially all the participants for your motivations and patience of the listening for the whole session. Thank you so much, everyone. We will see you again on 28th May 2021 for the second series of National Talk, presenting by the Professor G.P. Prashan, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Tripura University, on the topic Management Academy Institute during the pandemic. So please join together. I request you all the participants. Okay, see you. Bye-bye for this session. Bye-bye, Dr.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Hello, bye-bye.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.